Depends on the tellers. You have to appoint tellers.
The first main business meeting of the 73rd World Science Fiction Convention will be in order. Thank you, everyone. Okay. You've been through this before, so we'll go a little faster. This is the first main business meeting. Your officers remain unchanged. I am the chair, Kevin Standley.
I've been changed so much since last night.
The deputy chair is Jared Dashoff, who will preside in my absence. The parliamentarian, Donald Eastlake, is also responsible for running the AV and slides. The secretary, Linda Dinneroff. The timekeeper, who has a lot more work to do today, is Jesse Pershing. The sergeant-at-arms in the audience is Joyce Reynolds Ward. She and her staff are responsible for the logistics of the meeting, including getting handouts to people, collecting ballots when we get to that point, and keeping doing the people mover functions. And the videographer, Lisa Hayes, at the back of the room with her staff, are doing the recordings. This meeting is being recorded, and unless we vote otherwise, anybody here can also record and photograph. These recordings will be posted to the YouTube Worldcon Events channel as quickly as possible, and if you were to search YouTube for 2015 WSFS Business Meeting, you would also find the 5 segments of yesterday's meeting already up. We are very grateful to DETCON 1 for the grant of additional equipment, the specialty equipment that allowed us to get the quick recordings up online. We will have higher resolution versions of the recordings up at a later date. And because of the recording equipment's technical limitations, we will have a short technical timeout approximately every 30 minutes to allow the camera cartridges to be swapped. As with yesterday, if you are able to come to the microphone, you do need to come and speak into that so that you can be heard. That means facing the audience and the microphone, not turning to speak to us up on the head table. Although you are theoretically speaking only to the chair, that's me, you actually speak to the audience. Don't turn your back on the audience, which is the membership. If you haven't already done so, when you get a chance, note your presence on the attendance list. There are business meeting attendee ribbons back there on the set table. The secretary also has them. And if you have not already done so, silence all of your sound-making devices. And if you do get a call while you are in here, quickly answer it and leave the room. Do not take your calls here in the room. All right. We are now in the first main business meeting. We need to pick up where we left off yesterday. We did all of the things we had to do, but that did leave a number of things that we often do at the preliminary meeting left over until today. Today we will start with the elections for the WSFS Mark Protection Committee. We will receive committee reports, some of which conclude motions. Some of the committees have very short, minimal reports and have asked me to just take their reports as read. They are all in the printed agenda. We will take up the resolutions. And then I expect there's a chance that will take us all the way up to the point where we have a scheduled meeting at 11 o'clock of a committee of the whole to discuss the Hugo-related items that were referred to it yesterday. But if not, we will either then or after the committee of the whole, we will move into the ratification of constitutional amendments passed on from last year, and then we will pick up new constitutional amendments. Anything unfinished today, we will attempt to do tomorrow, and if we don't get it done tomorrow, it'll happen at the beginning of Sunday's meeting before the items that were sent to the Sunday meeting. I'd like to remind everyone that in general, unless you are physically unable to do so, in order to be recognized by the chair, you must stand. I will generally not call upon people who are raising their hands unless you have made arrangements for physical handicap reasons. And if you end up standing along the sides of the room or in the back of the room, I will never call on you. All right. Are there any questions on procedure? All right. I want to remind people that if you picked up a Mark Protection Committee ballot, it is a preferential ballot that you need to mark 1, 2, 3, 4. Do not just mark X's in the boxes. If you mark a bunch of X's in the boxes, it spoils your ballot. It doesn't count. You need to get a fresh ballot if you do that.
Well, of course, this goes in there somewhere. All right. In there somewhere.
Let me move into these committee, we are committee reports. There we go. Yeah, we're, let's go to slide eight, which is, there we go. The Mark Protection Committee reported yesterday, and nominations were taken for the Mark Protection Committee. At this time, at the beginning of the meeting, it is an opportunity now to finish marking your Mark Protection Committee ballot. Again, mark that as a preferential ballot. I don't really want to necessarily close it with people still managing to come in here. I'm going to come back to it. Let's go ahead and go on to the next item, and we'll probably close polls in a few minutes. Just a heads up to the sergeant at arms. When we do close the polls, I'm going to want the sergeants at arms to go down the aisles and collect the ballots and turn them into the tellers. Would the two tellers please stand for a moment here? Mr. Illingworth and Mr. Dashoff the Elder are the committee of tellers.
Can I call you Junior?
No.
But it'd be so funny.
I know.
But speaking of Mr. Illingworth, let's see here. Oh, actually, we gave your report yesterday. I'm sorry. The nitpicking and fly-specking committee is next. They gave their committee report yesterday. Their one resolution was adopted unanimously at the very beginning of the meeting. Yeah, we'll have more. The committee will have more to do next year. And that then takes us on to item three on this, which is the Worldcon Runners Editorial Committee. Mr. Wilmoth, do you have a report?
Good timing. I just got here.
Yeah, there you go.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Mike Wilmoth, and I'm the...
You can take the microphone out and speak into it.
Thanks. My name is Mike Wilmoth, and I'm the chairman of the Worldcon Runner's Guide Committee. Because all of us were busy with Sasquan this year, we didn't make a lot of progress. But again, we made incremental progress in updating the online guide. If anybody's interested in the URL, please see me after the meeting. I can give that to you. But we continue to make little progress and, move this forward.
Very well. The business meeting chair reappoints the members of the committee as currently constituted with the existing permission to augment its membership at its discretion.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And let me see. Item four is the formulation of long list entries. Their report is in writing, and they have no additional oral report. We'll come back to their motion when we get it in the agenda. Next, number five is the YA Hugo Award Study Committee, and I believe they have a short report besides their long written report. Ms. Rask, are you? Oh, there we go. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Katie Rask. I was the chair of the committee this year. The committee was formed last year as a sort of second version of a previous committee, and our goal was to consider the very many issues that have been raised in business meetings in the past regarding a YA Hugo Award, the possibility of it, what sort of things would need to be addressed, what problems there might be, so on and so forth. Our goal wasn't necessarily to put forth a proposal, but to deal with some of the issues that have not been dealt with before. So the committee discussed throughout the year various issues on a Yahoo forum, and we came up with the following. Our report is on page 66. It's the last report in the Worldcon gigantic tome that we have gotten this year for the business meeting. So I would like to note the history of this issue very briefly. This is in the first paragraph of our report. YA Hugo was first proposed, I'm told, in 1991 in Chicago. However, I'm also told that various other members of our organization attempted to get something together in 1989. So this is an issue that has been around for over 25 years. A portion of our community has been trying to push this forward for a quarter of a century at least. So the committee decided or addressed various things, and our findings were that, one, an award is a reasonable request. right? It is necessary and it is reasonable for there to be a YA or a teen lit award. However, as you can see for number two here on page 66, we came to the conclusion that under the existing methodology of the Hugo Awards, we couldn't actually put together a YA award. And you'll see as we continue, that the Hugo fiction categories are defined by word count, not by age categories. Okay. So under that existing methodology, we couldn't create an award. That would be a Hugo Award. Now, I want to point out that in our report, we have various appendices, or we call them exhibits here, exhibit 1, 2, 3, and 4, which further details some of the issues that we dealt with. So in exhibit 1, we address some of the common concerns that have been raised in business meetings in the past about whether an award is even necessary. So you see that the first issue that is commonly raised is, why have another award when YA books are already eligible? Look, Harry Potter won, right? So we have, I guess you could say, a response to this. And our findings were that the Hugos have not necessarily done a good job of representing YA works in the past. And you can see that in our exhibit 3, we actually have a comparison between the Hugo Awards and the Newbery Awards. And in the last 50 years or whatever, five YA speculative fiction titles have been nominated for a Hugo. And in that time, 35 or 36 YA speculative fiction works have been nominated for the Newberries. So that's just a comparison of the fact that there are many possible books out there that are high quality, that are award winning, that might be options for the Hugo. But I'm not gonna go into detail about that. You can read that on your own. The second section here addresses the issue of whether YA is a subgenre, which many people refer to it as a genre. And the second section explains that most people do not consider it a genre. It's considered an age category, right? Something completely different. So you can read that on your own. And number 3, will anyone at Worldcon know anything about YA? And so would they be qualified to vote? And I think we actually have some really good data here, particularly that first bullet point, which is based on the YA programming track at LunCon. And you can see the 36 YA lit panels that were there, the number of presenters, so on and so forth, right? Exhibit 2, which is page 69, explains how people tend to define YA, which has always been a concern of the business meeting. And you'll note that for most awards, YA is not defined. Finally, in Exhibit 3, we have that Newbery Hugo comparison. And in Exhibit 4, we come to the main gist here, which is that the committee thinks that it has not really been able to address all of the issues, that we believe that we need a second year, specifically so that we can further address the issue of a non-Hugo award, something like a Campbell sort of award, based on this issue with the present Hugo methodology. So we are asking the membership for a second year to continue as we are, but to take on new people. Anyone else who wants to be in the committee could join us.
We'll stick here for a question.
Sure.
Oh. Joshua Kroningold. So did you consider the possibility of targeting YA with a length category using the existing Hugo methodology?
Yes, we did. And in our Exhibit 4, we have a list of some of the questions that we would not just consider, but also research in more detail for the following year. And that would be whether there would be a word length limit. Probably 40,000 words would be a good place to start. For a shorter novel, YA books can be very long, but they can also be shorter. So we would like to research in greater detail common word lengths or lengths of books, so on and so forth.
Mm-hmm. May I please just turn another question?
Sure.
You should be a member of the committee.
Yes, please don't come to the microphone with your mouth full.
And there are 3 minutes left for this report.
Okay. Apologies. Just to specify the question, whether there is a length category that is covered by the Hugos in which that is also underrepresented and matches YA. And that therefore one could target YA by adding an extra length category to the Hugos as a possibility, which has been raised in several fora at this point.
So if I understand your question, you are asking whether we might find a particular length category that we could call YA, or that is usually YA. YA usually falls under this length category, and so therefore that would we could sort of work that into the Hugo methodology.
I think we are getting into too low a level of detail at this point. I'd like the committee to wind up the report if we could.
Okay, yes, that's something that we can look into in more detail in the coming year, but we can also talk about that. I think there are actually some objections to that as well. So
the chair observes that should this committee be continued, he is going to continue it with its existing membership and explicitly appoint Mr. Croningold to it.
Any other questions?
Okay, thank
okay.
you.
Dang it.
So close.
Mr. Olson, did you intend the same thing with the types and rates committee? Okay. The WSFS Membership Types and Rates Committee submitted a written report. It is in your agenda and has no oral report. All right. Before we get to the resolutions, is there anyone who wishes to vote in the Mark Protection?
Can you ask for objections to continuing the committee or something?
I haven't got to the resolution. It's in the resolutions.
Okay.
It's in the resolution. All of the continuation motions are in the resolutions. We'll get to them in a minute. So before we get to the various resolutions, is there anybody wishing to vote in the Mark Protection Committee elections who has not voted, who has not cast their ballot? Now, you're holding up your ballots to say you have voted. Is there anybody who wants to vote who hasn't gotten a ballot? Okay. Questions? There are questions. All right, is there somebody, I see one person who didn't get a ballot.
Two.
Okay, would the sergeant at arms get ballots to those people? You have very little time. I would really like to close the polls now. Hold your hand up if you did not get a ballot and you need a ballot. Hold your hand up if you need a ballot and you did not get a ballot. Okay. All right then. This is a preferential ballot. You need to mark your choices 1, 2, 3, 4. Do not just mark them with an X.
Ballot.
Who needed a ballot? Who needs a ballot? Mr. Wilmoth over there needs a ballot. Quickly, please. If you need a ballot, only if you need a ballot. You need a ballot over here. If you no. Need a ballot. All right, we are dealt with. Is there any objection to closing the polls at this time? The chair reminds the members that the way that you indicate that you do not object is to say nothing. If even one person starts talking, I'm going to hear it as an objection and have to take a vote. You do yourselves no favor by being clever. Without objection, the polls are now closed. The sergeants at arms will now move along the aisles. Those of you who have voted, fold your ballots in half once and hand them to a sergeant at arms as they move along the aisles. It's to the end.
To the
aisles.
Joyce, can you grab
pass your ballots to the nearest aisle.
And Joyce.
Joyce, the head table.
We have no center aisle.
Mr. Illingworth and Mr. Todd Dashoff will take the ballots and count them and report back later in the meeting.
Oh, he's clever. He's putting them in a box.
She collected the head table. The member will come to the microphone and state her parliamentary inquiry.
I'm Kate. I would like to know at
Speak what... Speak more clearly, closer to the microphone,
Sorry.
Please.
At what point it would be in order... My name is Kate Secor. I would like to know at what point it would be in order to present the report from the committee that was constituted yesterday on the matter of the electronic signatures amendment.
When that item comes up in the agenda as a new constitutional amendment.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Do we have all ballots? Is there anybody who wanted to vote who has not turned in their ballot? Hearing none, the polls are now closed completely. We'll get results later in the meeting. Let's see. I think this would be the right place then to take our first technical timeout slightly early, because that way it's a natural break. This meeting is adjourned for 2 minutes. The meeting will return to order. Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, that's fine. The committee reports have a typo in it. Comes from doing too many global replaces. It's not that big a deal. Let's move on to slide 9 and the resolutions. These resolutions did not have time limits adopted on them, so we need to start each one by adopting a time limit for it. The first item is a Hugo Award eligibility extension request to move to extend the Hugo eligibility for the movie I Remember the Future due to extremely limited distribution. This requires a two-thirds vote. Is there any objection to 4 minutes debate?
2 minutes.
2 minutes. Zero is not permitted. 1 minute. All right.
Remember what I said about odd numbers? I will hunt you down.
All right. Choices are 4 and 2 and 1. All those in favor of 4 minutes, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposed? Hands down. 4 minutes is adopted. Is the maker of the motion here? Yeah. Oh, there you go. The chair recognizes Mr. Barkley.
Yes.
Hello, I'm Chris Barkley. I'm here representing Michael Burstein and Nomi Burstein in a plea to continue for this continuing resolution. I ask that we beg your indulgence, because this film did receive limited distribution.
Whoop. Yeah. No, it went dead.
Thank you, Mr. Eastlake. And we would like to beg your indulgence to continue this resolution so that this particular and remarkable film will be considered for next year's Hugos. We also would like to give our support to Predestination as well, and I thank you very much.
Is there a speech against? Any speech in favor? Hearing none. Is there any objection to this resolution? There is objection. A two-thirds vote. Oops. Hang on. I'll do this right way. A two-thirds vote being necessary to adopt this resolution. All those in favor of adopting resolution B21, I Remember the Future, extending its Hugo eligibility, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposed? Hands down. There being two-thirds in the affirmative, the motion is adopted. This work's eligibility is extended. A moment for secretarial catch-up. We're good?
Yes.
Okay. Item B22, which is Hugo eligibility extension for Predestination. Move to extend for 1 year the eligibility of the movie Predestination based on limited availability. Is there any objection to 4 minutes? Hearing none, we are adopting 4 minutes on that one. I think you may have noticed it takes more time to set debate than you saved. Thank you. Okay, is the maker of this motion present? Yes. Come. Yeah, there we go. Yeah, the mic. Secretary down here.
Thank you.
Mr. Kingsley? Yes, the chair recognizes Mr. Kingsley.
Michael Kingsley, I think that this film is definitely worthy of a Hugo. It is an Australian film that was first presented to the public at South by Southwest in 2014. It was then presented to the public at the Sydney Film Festival later that year. And I found out through File 770, apparently in late 2014, there were some international flights where the film was shown. However, for most people, and I assume most people in this room, it wasn't available until 2015 when it was released on DVD, on demand, and I think through one other venue I can't think of right now.
But the member is reminded that you speak to the audience, not to the head table.
Thank you. But I'm finished with my speech. Thank you.
Is there anyone who wishes to speak against this motion? Without objection, we will bring it to a vote. A two-thirds vote being necessary to extend the eligibility of this work. All those in favor of extending the work's eligibility, raise your hands. Hands down, those opposed. Hands down, there being two-thirds in the affirmative, the motion is carried and the eligibility of this work is extended. The chair notes a typo in his slide where he said 16, he meant 6. I typed 16 where I meant 6. All right. I did that slide at 11 o'clock last night after doing match game. Thing. All right. In this room, I might add. Item B23 is Hugo nominating data request. Moved that the WSFS business meeting requests that the administrators of the 2015 Hugo Awards make publicly available anonymized raw voting data from the 2015 Hugo Awards, including the works nominated on each ballot in each category, but not including any information that could be used to relate ballots to the to the members who cast them, and resolved that it is the opinion of the business meeting that releasing such anonymized raw voting data after the announcement of the results of the 2015 Hugo Awards is not a violation of the privacy of members' ballots. Before I continue, the chair does observe that this is merely a request. The administrators of the Hugo Awards have complete and total authority under the WSFS Constitution to do as they will with this. They do not have to release it, or they can release it at their discretion. The chair suggests 6 minutes debate time on this. 10 and 20 and 4 and 16, just because I dive at it. And I hear 2 and 8. That's enough, I think. Jared will read them back. Mr. Dashoff?
That's
bring it closer, Jared.
If your chair were closer.
Yeah, if my chair were closer.
Sit closer to you.
20, 16, 10, 8, 6, 4, and 2.
It's like you're on an episode of Sesame Street.
Those in favor of 20 minutes, raise your hands. Hands down, those opposed.
Good.
Thank you. No, it does not happen. What's next, 16?
Yes.
16,
those in favor of 16 minutes, raise your hands. Hands down, those opposed. That does not pass. What's next?
10.
All in favor of 10 minutes, raise your hands. Hands down, those opposed. That does not pass.
8.
All those in favor of 8 minutes, raise your hands. Hands down, those opposed. Still doesn't have it. 6 minutes. All those in favor. All those opposed, hands down, those opposed. 6 minutes is adopted. See, if you just listen to me in the first place. All right. The maker of the motion has preference in speaking here. Mr. Watt.
I think you had a question.
Yeah. For what purpose did the member rise? The member will, Mr. Watt, will you please yield for the parliamentary inquiry? Come to the microphone.
Aaron Davies. Just a question about the exact text of the amendment. The version in the printed program says in both places anonymized raw nominating data.
If I left the word nominating out when I reread, the version as printed is correct.
You said voting both times.
I apologize for misreading it. The printed version is correct. Nominating data is what it's meant.
Okay.
The printed version in the agenda is correct.
Thank you. Normally I wouldn't care, but in this case
that's you're quite right. That's fine. All right. The chair recognizes Mr. Watt.
Thank you. My name is Keenel Watt. For those of you who didn't meet me yesterday. This is a fairly low-pressure thing. As we were developing EPH, we realized that it was very handy to have some actual data that we could use for developing the situation. And it doesn't just apply to us. It applies to anybody. It's great for transparency. We did actually have the 1984 actual ballots that we used for testing and for as we were doing our developments. We also took the 2013 nomination data and did a statistical sampling that matched that. But we had a lot more confidence in the 1984 because, you know, it's the real thing. We don't feel that it would violate any kind of privacy issues or anything like that. Even if we, no matter what we decide to do with the Hugos, it's useful information and it's historical information. The Hugos this year, for better or worse, are going to be a historical item. It's been one of the more important years that we've had. And if for no other reason than to have that available for us, you know, 50 years from now, I think that it's important that we have that. So thank you very much.
Mr. Lorenz, speaking against the proposal. For what purpose does the member rise?
I wanted to ask the speaker a question.
Too late. He'd already yielded the floor when you rose. Thank you.
My name is John Lorenz. I believe that this resolution violates the Constitution of WSFS under Section 3.11.4 about releasing the voting totals. It includes a statement that during the same period, the nomination vote total shall also be published, including each category. In each category, the vote counts for at least top 15 vote getters and any other nominee receiving number of votes equal to at least 5% of the nomination ballots cast in the category, but not including any nominee receiving fewer than 5 votes.
Is the member raising a point of order that the motion is out of order for this purpose?
Yes, I suppose so.
Yeah. Okay, that's important because the chair rules the point of order not well taken. The chair rules that the wording in version in 3.14 is a minimum, not a maximum, and that it is permissible for the administrators to release more than the information that is listed here, but it must...
Okay.
Does the member want to appeal the ruling?
Yes, I want to appeal the ruling.
Is there a second to the appeal? Second to the appeal. Okay. That's an appeal, and it's going to end up using up all... Probably going to end up using all the debate time on the motion, but okay. The chair has a basic, again, an appeal works like this. The chair speaks on why he thinks the ruling is correct.
The chair gives the timekeeper a second.
The chair gives the timekeeper some time to catch up with it, yeah. This is an appeal.
Let me do some quick math. What is this?
Hang on a second. This is an appeal, okay. Since the secretary asked, Mr. Lorenz raised a point of order that the motion on the resolution was out of order as unconstitutional and stated why. The chair ruled that the point of order was not well taken and stated why. Mr. Lorenz has appealed the ruling of the chair. The question before us is, shall the ruling of the chair stand? Okay, as soon as the timekeeper is ready. The chair believes that the wording in this motion or the wording in 3.11.4 represents the minimum requirement, not a maximum, and that administrators are allowed but not required to release more information than is provided here. Mr. Lorenz.
Okay.
Speaking
against the chair's ruling, it says the wording says specifically the nomination voting totals shall be published, and it also includes that not including any nominee receiving fewer than five votes. Therefore, I believe that it specifically says we shall release these, and we are not allowed to release the ones receiving fewer than five votes. I realize that the chair views this differently, but I think that the words matter.
Okay, who would like to speak in favor of the chair's ruling? Parliamentary inquiry. The member will come up front and state the parliamentary inquiry. Well, you have to put it as an inquiry and request. That's fine.
I'd like to request that the secretary put. I would like to request
name.
Sorry, my name is Carl Fink. I'd like to request the secretary put the exact wording of the Constitution up on the screen so that the members can.
That'd be the parliamentarian, actually.
Parliamentarian, my mistake.
Mr. Eastlake, do you have the Constitution handy? It's Carl with the C, right? Carl F-I-N-K.
Oh, okay.
Just go to this is using up time, I know, but the parliamentarian is going to get a hold of the Constitution and bring the wording, which is in your program book, by the way.
He's just been using up time in the sense of.
I have mine here. I brought it up, but it is section 3.11.4 in question. Once we have it up, I'm going to.
5 minutes.
And then we're going to make it a little larger, I think, if we can.
Apple Plus, since it's this.
No, other one. Don't hit shift.
Yep, keep going.
Whoops. Overshot, that's it.
It did get bigger.
It's not changing. No, it's.
Okay, tell you what.
I do believe Mr. Eastlake knows how to use a web browser. Give him a moment, please.
That's good.
He's working on it, okay?
Control A is your friend.
That's about the best we'll do there. Okay, there's the wording on the screen. The chair. There. Okay.
Good. I have stopped.
Stop. Okay, fine. All right. The next person in line would be somebody speaking in favor of the chair's ruling. Ms. Turek.
Ooh.
I'm giving preference to the fan guest of honor here,
that's
folks.
That's a wild card. Didn't really expect that one.
It seems pretty clear.
Yeah, take the microphone out and just, there, speaking.
Name.
Leslie Turek.
Fan guest of honor.
That's not required. it seems pretty clear to me that phrase was put in there just to reduce the burden on the committee so that they didn't feel like they had to list every single little thing that got nominated, which would probably be a list of a few hundred things. So I think the chair's right that it's not meant to preclude it. It's just saying you don't have to do it.
A speech against the chair's ruling, Mr. Yellow.
Getting real close.
Yes.
Come on. John, you got to do it.
Wait, I can ding people before they talk. If it would give you the big one instead of me.
Took it off.
Historically, sorry, Ben Yellow, remember to check me off. Yes. Historically, nothing was released initially. There was then an extensive discussion and an elaborate compromise was reached between the people who wanted everything released and the people who felt that the traditional nothing should be released. This compromise was resulting in the wording that you see there as what people thought was the best way to split the difference between the two factions. And nothing else was intended when we passed this section.
Is that time against the chair's
yeah.
is expired? Do we have, how much time in favor of the chair's ruling?
About 50 seconds.
50?
Yes.
50 seconds?
Yes.
What was the question? Who had a... The motion to close debate is not in order when there's less than 1 minute of debate time left.
Who had his hand up first?
Who had his hand up? And the far side over there? You, speech in favor of the chair's ruling? Go.
You, somebody take the microphone.
Take, if you, oh, we don't have the wireless mic. It ran out of bat. Can you take the, is the wireless working again?
No.
Okay. Oh, he can get up there. Okay.
Batteries are at the other end of the convention.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Okay, my name is Mike Stern. My badge says rabble rouser. I think that the defining words in this are at least. Okay? At least says you can do more. Okay? And that's it.
The chair will use his right to speak last on this. The... It seems obvious to me, but it not necessarily to everybody, that it is a minimum requirement and not a maximum. But it's a reasonable...
So we're done with this. So this one has to be...
No, this is still the appeal. Yeah, yeah, no. But this is...
Sorry.
Yeah, this is specifically the appeal time. No, just
thank you. But it is a reasonable position for people to disagree upon. It is the purpose of this meeting's. The meeting is going to be ruling on this. Do bear in mind that no matter which way the meeting votes on this, it's going to go into the rulings of continuing effect. So you are setting a precedent here one way or the other. The question is on whether the chair's ruling that the wording in 311.4 is a minimum, not a maximum, and therefore the motion on the floor is in order. That's what the ruling is. The chair, that's the chair's ruling. Those who are in favor of the chair's ruling, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposed to the chair's ruling, hands down. There being less than a majority in the negative, the chair's ruling is sustained. The motion is in order. We have used up all debate time on the proposal. Mr. Glazer.
My name is Glenn Glazer. I move to extend debate by 6 minutes.
Is there any objection to extending debate for 6 minutes?
Yes.
Very well. Then in that case, a two-thirds vote being necessary to extend debate. All those in favor of extending debate by 6 minutes, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposed? Hands down. There being less than two-thirds, the debate is not extended. Debate time is over. Mr. Cronengold? You can move to amend. Come to the microphone then. Yes. Mr. Cronengold, hold off for the secretary to get a chance to get caught up, but go ahead and go to the microphone. I'll let you know.
And would take all that. I see.
Okay. I'm caught up.
Mr. Cronengold.
I move to amend the motion under consideration to add the words, I believe they're, but not including candidates receiving fewer than five votes, fewer than five nominations.
Okay. Okay. Hang on just a moment.
There's no debate time.
I believe we can take the words directly out of the Constitution.
I'm trying to find the right spot for it. Thank you. No. I know what he's doing.
To the resolution.
He's adding it to the resolution, but not including... Okay. This would be to add at the end of the first clause on page 27 of your agenda, following the words where it says, but not including any information that could be used to relate ballots to members who cast them, and not including any... nominees that receive fewer than five or fewer votes, or was it fewer than five nominations? Fewer than five nominations. Is there a second to his motion?
Second.
This is not debatable.
A point of order?
We have yet to resolve the appeal of the chair's motion.
Yes, we did. We just did.
Oh, sorry.
The vote was to sustain the chair. That was what the vote was. The members are please reminded that if you are not sure what you are voting on, you need to stop me and ask what we are voting on, okay? I'm going to assume you know what you're voting on unless you say otherwise. For what purpose does the member rise? I'm trying to take a vote. This is not a constitutional amendment. That is debate upon the motion. This is an undebatable motion because debate time has expired. On the question to add a rider to the last sentence of the first clause of the amendment to restrict it to works that receive more than five votes, nominations, thank you. All those in favor of the amendment, raise your hands. Hands down, those opposed. The negative has it, the amendment does not pass. On the motion, as originally published. Sorry, what?
Can I suggest to people who wish to gain the floor not only stand, but also yell, Mr. Chairman,
point.
Or something?
Yes.
Because
Doctor,
otherwise, they may not be noticed.
That's right. Dr. Lurie.
Oh, come on.
I wish to amend the resolution to add the administrators of the 2015 and 2016 Hugo Awards so that we will have information next year when we might be ratifying something we vote on this year.
This is a motion to globally replace 2015 with 2015 and 2016 everywhere it appears in the motion. Is there a second? All those in favor of the amendment, raise your hands. Hands down, those opposed. Hands down, the affirmative has it. Did a member just move?
Yes.
Yes, the secretary is trying to catch up because you are now going very fast.
And I also just need to ask you.
We need to proceed with deliberate speed, not excessive speed.
Okay, so that's been approved, right?
It has been approved.
And you can call the question going up.
You can't call the question.
The chair will now read the amended motion. And this is what we'll be voting on when I get through it. Unless some of you have... I'm sorry. There was a motion to end the debate and bring it to a vote. Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
All those in favor of ending the debate and the making of any subsidiary motions, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposed... Hands down, there being two-thirds in the affirmative, debate and further discussion and subsidiary motions is ended.
I totally missed what happened.
Oh, okay.
Was there a yell for
me? I don't know. I missed whatever just happened. I didn't catch it. I don't know what happened.
Okay. That's item B23. This is what we'll be voting upon. Moved that the WSFS business meeting request that the administrators of the 2015 and 2016 Hugo Awards make publicly available anonymized raw nominating data from the 2015 and 2016 Hugo Awards, including the works nominated on each ballot in each category, but not including any information that could be used to relate ballots to the members who cast them, and resolve that it is the opinion of the WSFS business meeting that releasing such anonymized raw nominating data after the announcement of the results of the 2015 or 2016 Hugo Awards is not a violation of the privacy of members' ballots. A majority being necessary to adopt this amendment. All those in favor of the resolution, all those in favor, raise your hands. Hands down, those opposed. Hands down, the affirmative has it, this resolution is adopted. Mr. Glazer, member will state their question of privilege.
For those of you who don't know, I'm the Vice Chair of Business and Finance for this convention. I'm a Glenn Glazer. Hugo administration falls under my purview. We had some discussion about this resolution prior to today. And while many of us have grave reservations about this resolution, it is our intent to comply with the will of the business meeting.
Wait just a moment, Mr. Glazer. Is there any, has anything been done on the practical implementation details of the request? Does any member of the Hugo Administration Committee want to speak
Ron,
to it?
Ron, would you like to talk to that?
Mr. Oakes.
Ron Oakes, as the current developer of the Hugo web application and the keeper of the database, we do have the technical capability of delivering the anonymized data in a file, hopefully before the Sunday business meeting. So,
That's when they won it.
You're intending to distribute it to the convention website or something of that nature? Or? I'm not asking your permission. I'm asking the convention what it plans to do. Yeah. Yes, please.
So we know of one particular request for this. We will deliver that one on a stick. Not a pike. And for the rest, if you are interested in this information, please email hugoadmin@sasquan.org and we'll make arrangements. I don't really feel comfortable with posting this on a website. But we will certainly transparently make it freely available to anyone who asks, and I may put something on the website that says, if you're interested in this, ask for it this way.
Okay, that deals with that. We are actually just slightly early for that, but I do believe the next item would be very time consuming. I want to try a couple of things here. There are three minor resolutions on slide 9 there that we go. The continuation of the Folly YA Committee and the Membership Rates and Types Committees. Are there any objection to continuing these committees as currently constituted? Hearing none, without objection, resolutions B27, 8, and 9 are adopted. The chair appoints their existing committees as currently constituted with the addition of Mr. Cronengold to the YA Award Committee. And all of these committees have their existing charges that they may supplement their members at the discretion of their committee chairs, continued.
Okay, what
7, 8, and 9, B27, B28. The secretary asks me for clarification. The items listed in your agenda as B27, B28, and B29 were all adopted, basically because of no objection. The rules were suspended. All three motions were immediately adopted. Their committees were continued as constituted. They're motions. They're motions that come out. They're motions that came out of the committees, and I listed them as 7, 8, and 9. They're just not in the printed agenda. Each of those committees moved its own continuation, and that they are motions even if they're not in the form of resolutions. Mr. Bloom.
All right, so give me a couple of seconds to catch up here.
Does the chairman of the committee want to speak to that?
That is correct. Let's not wasting time. We can not
meet
and
we'll
work just fine.
Since the committee, I misunderstood the committee's report. I thought it wanted to be continued. I think we deal better to just go ahead and let it go, okay? That brings us up very, yes? Had a bingo there. I forgot there. I did need to. The members spoke from the floor, and I didn't restate them. It was stated that the report of the membership type rates and types committee actually called for itself to be on hiatus for a year, but the chairman of that committee said, "Oh, it's not to go ahead and continue it anyway. It can just not meet," and that deals with that anyway.
Chairman.
Yes. Question of privilege. Yes.
My name's Kate Secor. If we're going to take a break before we move on to B24, yes. I would request that it be long enough that it can be a bio break.
Yeah, I'm aware of that. I'm trying to. Before anybody tries to get it, it is time for a break. This meeting is about to recess, and when it reconvenes, it will reconvene as a committee of the whole to discuss the 4-6 and YA Hugo. The meeting is in recess approximately 10 minutes, I believe. I said why Hugo. I keep it for the Hugo, the EPH and 4-6. Is 11 is 10 after the hour? Okay.
Sure.
Yeah. This meeting is in recess until 11:11. What? We'll get it when we reconvene, I promise.
The meeting will return to order.
That's so cool.
Okay, but you're covering up my bingo card.
Oh, I'm sorry. It is the chair's intent to address the 4 and 6 motion first, and then the EPH motion. Is there any objection to that order? Seeing none, I will recognize the makers of the 4 and 6 motion for a very brief discussion of how their motion works, and then to yield to questions in the order recognized by the chair.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. My name is Chris Garam. I am the head cook and bottle washer of 4 and 6. How it works is very simple. Everyone votes for an unranked list of nominees, 4 per category. The administrators take the top 6 plus any ties and put them on the final ballot. We vote on the final ballot the same way we do everything else. We do it on preferential. There is nothing magical about the numbers 4 or 6. If you like a different number, we can certainly talk about that. You know, 3 and 10 or 5 and 10 or whatever makes sense. The intent, of the amendment, in large part is there's two intents. The first intent is, number one, there are a lot of people who, when they see this list, that they've got to fill out 5 titles. They throw their reading list at the title. They throw everything they've ever read in that category, or every fan writer they know in that category, and they throw it in there. Being an explicit less than the number we're going to actually vote on, I think gives us the signal that says you can list the ones you actually like as opposed to just everyone you ever read. The second thing is, those folks who shall not be named came up with a slate, and that slate of about 250 voters, or about 20% of the nominators, people who voted to nominate, locked everything up. If you break it up in a slate, if you break up the number of nominations and make it different than the number of finalists, you force a slate to either concede part of the slate, part of the final ballot, or you force them to try to split their forces in half, which dilutes their ability to do something. So that's kind of how it would work. As far as administration, I can't see it being any more difficult than the current administration. It does not disenfranchise anybody. Everyone still gets to vote. Everyone still gets to vote on the finalists. I guess I'm going to yield to questions at this point.
Is there any member with a question? Do you need the roving mic?
I wish to amend the motion. My name is Milt Stevens, Mr. Chairman. All right, state my suggested amendment.
Yes.
To change the number 4 to 5.
Motions on the wording of the motions are not in order. That is substantive debate and will be heard on Sunday when the motion comes up for suspense.
You can amend the...
Yes. The chair recognizes Kevin Stanley.
Mr. Chairman, I do believe that it... Kevin Stanley... No, it's... Don't use up your 30 minutes. Mr. Chairman, I do believe it would be in order for the Committee of the Whole to recommend that the meeting amend the motion in such a way. So I do believe the members... actually proposing that that we adopt a recommendation in our report to the main meeting that we amend the motion by substituting 5 and 8 for 4 and 6. Is that perhaps correct what it was? And I do second the member's motion. If the point of order is held, well taken.
I was really trying not to get into numbers game right now, but The point of order is well taken. If the member would like to restate the numbers that he would like the committee to report back with.
To substitute the number 4 for 5 and the number 6 for 8.
The other way around, yes. 8 for 6.
8 for 6.
Seeing as how this is a committee of the whole, I'm going to ask if there is any objection to reporting back with that as a change.
Mr. Chair, may I suggest that I suspect there are several other people who have numbers.
Which is why I didn't want to get into this.
Well, yeah, I agree, Mr. Chair, but maybe we ought to just take all the numbers and see what kind of shakes out.
The chair is going to ask that any members who wish to change numbers provide them to the chair at the close of this discussion, since I assume we are going to recess between now and the other part of the meeting, and I will report back to the committee or to the business meeting with the full list of proposed numbers. For what purpose does Mr. Breitbart rise?
Seth Breitbart, I wish to propose an amendment by substitution to that amendment to say that this committee of the whole reports back that the set of numbers should be set by fill-in-the-blanks procedure at the regular business meeting, since that's going to happen anyway, no matter what we report.
I will ask for an objection to the motion. Seeing none, that is adopted. We will report back to that the main business meeting should approach the numbers as a fill-in-the-blank system.
Mr. Chair, I think if there's any other questions on how to do things, I think we can have some questions. So.
Hi, David Clements. A question for the Speaker. If the intent of this amendment, I believe that's the correct term, is to defeat block voting, I'm uncertain that a short list, a list of finalists that is two-thirds dominated by a block, where you know, they all decide to vote for 4 works, we get left with 2 others which are not part of a block. I don't think that achieves things quite as well as many of us might wish. We would end up with a situation that's analogous to the novel shortlist this year, which is still problematic, even though several non-affected works are on that shortlist.
What point well taken? The point well taken. I think the important factor to consider is the ratio. What ratio do you feel comfortable with? How many, non-slate works you do want? I also think it's important to note that the slate people do not have a complete control of their, it's not a party discipline where they can make people vote the way they want. There was a 25% runoff between the first and the fifth work in the short fiction slates. So they do have some problems of their own as far as internal organization, for lack of a better word.
Very quickly, it is the opinion of the chair that the fill-in-the-blanks to be filled in do not need to be in the same proportion. It is numbers, so we don't have to stick with two-thirds. And I will also note that we are approaching 10 minutes debate or discussion on this matter, and we do have another matter to discuss. I saw Mr. Kowalczyk first, so I will recognize him.
Good, Rick Kowalczyk, good try, but any set of numbers that isn't like 1 and 27 is imminently gameable, and probably about half the people in this room can figure out how a slate, even if you do 4 and 12, you can game it.
Well, you can, yes, you can game it. This, the point, though, is if it's a big, it requires a larger majority to game the system, and if it's a big enough majority, then they should win it anyway. If 40% of the people who vote want, you know, whatever work on the ballot, they should get it, whether they, you know, whether everyone here agrees with them or not.
For what purpose does the member rise?
Dara Koroti asking the 4 and 6 committee, have they even closer, all right. Dara Koroti asking the committee, have you considered the inevitability of multiple independent slates? I'm not talking coordinated action, because two independent slates, each running four candidates, will have, between the two of them, 100% of the ballot, making it a partisan ballot under any circumstances that there are more than one slate.
Yes, if you have multiple slates, you will have a partisan ballot.
Yes, Mr. Stanley.
He's going to shut me down, folks.
Kevin Stanley, I believe the charge to this committee was to discuss the technical aspects, and I do very much believe we are reaching the element of heavily substantive debate that is better taken up at the main meeting. Mr. Chairman, if you do, is the point of order well taken?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman, I ask unanimous consent that we move on to the second item on the agenda for this committee.
Is there any objection to moving on to EPH?
Thank you.
Seeing none.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
The chair recognizes Mr. Watt to give a presentation very quickly on the procedure for EPH.
There are 19 minutes left.
Good morning, I'm Keith Watt. For those who don't remember from me, I'm trying to make my quick exit. So, I'm the lead for EPH, and once we get our presentation up here, we have a little less time than what I thought we did, so I'm going to kind of blast through this. But what I really wanted to do was just give you an overview of how the system works, because it's gotten a reputation for being very complicated, and it's actually not. There's only one part of it that is new and different and weird. I'll explain that part to you. Once you understand the motivation behind that, I think it'll make a whole lot more sense to you where you're coming from. So EPH is just a way of tallying nominations that minimizes slates. It doesn't change what you nominate, how you nominate, or what you can nominate. Our whole goal behind this was to make it absolutely, I'll get up so I don't walk, I'm a teacher, so I walk around the classroom. So, is to make it so that you don't change, you the voter, don't change your Hugo voting behavior. That was one of our fundamental principles behind all of this. And as they point out, now I'm looking at the 2013 data that I'm going to show you in just a minute, but we were able to set it so that 15% of the nominators were able to take 100% of all the nomination slots. And of course, that's very similar to what we saw in 2015 today. When we were trying to find an answer to this, what we figured out with the true cause of the problem was that we as fans nominate a wide diversity of works. And that's a feature. It's not a bug. It's something that we want to maintain. But because we're nominating all these very, you know, low numbers of votes for individual works, a slate that has good discipline can put their 200 votes and dominate all of the rest of us. So once we recognized the problem, we started looking for a mechanism that would allow us to redirect that support from the works that didn't have a chance to begin with. So our guiding principle here was the Hugo Award should be representative of all of us, not just from, you know, one part. So the way it works is it allows the least supported nominee to be eliminated from consideration. When we do that, voters are redirecting their support. So just, I'll go into this in detail, but let's say you've got five works on your ballot, and it turns out that your fourth one doesn't have a chance. Under the current system, that vote's just basically wasted. What happens under the new system is it's eliminated as though you never voted for it, and you now have more support for your remaining works. Now, we need a better name for this, because this is just boring. But here's, we're calling it points right now. If you guys have a better name, please give it to us. So, that's something, yeah. So these points, this is the new part. This is the weird part. The points are our mechanism for redistributing that support. So in each category, you get 1 point. If you have five works on your nomination ballot, each work gets 1/5 of a point from you. All of those points then get added up together, and that's the point total, which is kind of a measure of popularity, so a measure of support for it. If any of your nominees are eliminated, then the remaining nominees get the rest of your points. So if I had five, each got a fifth. If one gets eliminated, each gets a fourth. If one gets eliminated, now each gets a third, and so on and so on. So the key to EPH is this. Points do not eliminate anything. Points just determine who is eligible for elimination. Our current system has always been the works with the most support are the ones with the most nominations, and we keep that. So the number of nominations determine who is actually eliminated. And so, and this was part in our early discussions that was missed by some people. Since the works are getting more points over time, fandom is concentrating our support into the final ballot. So we are not a political movement. We are not interested in saying, oh, you're a slate, you're bad, you're out. We may have personal opinions about that, but that's not what we're here, that's not our place to make. What we want to do, though, any set of nominees, whether they're from a slate or whatever, who tend to have both the same number of points and the same number of nominations, will tend to compete against each other. And so the way the slates are controlled is they end up competing against each other. And so those five works get eliminated to the most popular slate work. Because honestly, I'm not interested in keeping the slates off the ballot. They're fandom. They're part of us. If they have 20% of the electorate, they should have a slot. You know, that's how a fair, and no fair system is going to prevent that from happening. And so we explicitly designed that into the system. No Pharisees. Welcome to my world of captioning. If you want to have a laugh, watch Google and put on there, watch YouTube and put on auto captioning, but don't let your kids be around. The important thing here is that if there is no slate, if there's nothing that meets these conditions, EPH gives exactly the same results as the current system. It does no harm. So if you are a proponent of the social situation, of the social solutions, that, hey, it's people, not the system, I support that 100%. This gives us the safety net to make those solutions work. Okay, so here's how it works. Each category is a separate election.
Mr. Watt, I just want to note that we have just under 14 minutes left.
Okay, so we get through this, and I think we'll probably just move on then. There's three phases to it then. I'm not going to go into detail about this. I'll do this on Sunday if we need to, okay? So here we are counting up the number of points and nominations from all the ballots. We find the two lowest point totals. Those are the two that are least supported. One of those is going to get eliminated. It may not be the one with the least number of points. We just pick the two that are there. And then of those two, the one with the fewest nominations is gone. And so we start from the bottom up until we've got our five final. Tiebreakers, if we need it, we've just pulled that out of section 6.4. I'm not going to take the time to deal with tiebreakers. Okay, so this is the current system. We took the 2013 data and came up with a statistical distribution that matched the nominations, and then I manually added 200 slate ballots to that. So everything in the bottom part is essentially real data, statistically generated, and then we've added the slates. As you see under the current system, we have lots of votes here from fandom at large, but the slates still win. They take 100% of the slot. I'm going to skip ahead and just show you how one round works. This is particular one is round five. The shorter the line, the fewer number of points they have. So here we've taken the two shortest bars. They have least number of points. So this one had, number 24 had 23.58, number 19 had 22. Keep those in mind for just a minute. You see that number 24 had the most number of points.
Point of personal privilege,
I'm cutting out, is that what you're saying?
Cutting in and out. I don't know if it's because of the microphone or because you're not holding it in front of your mouth all the time.
Just take
cutting in and out.
Oh, I see. All right, I need to hold it closer, is what he's saying. Okay, sorry.
Or
thank you.
Better directionally coupled to your head.
That's right. Okay, I need one of the, I need a Britney Spears mic this way. Yeah. So notice that number 24 has the most number of points. Now those are our two lowest. We look at their nominations now, and you see that number 24 actually has fewer nominations. It's the one that's eliminated. Because nominations should decide who the winner is from them. Okay, I'm not gonna go through the rest of this. Here was the first combination of when the slates competed against each other, and you see that they will end up eliminating each other. So I'm just gonna fast forward through all this. So the results, under the current nomination system, the five nominees are the slates. The slate sweeps the ballot. Under EPH, the final ballot is 1, 2, 3, and 4, the four most popular non-slate works, plus one work from the slate.
And so the slate only gets one finalist slot. I'm going to, we're missing some slides, are they hidden? Since we're short on time, I'm going to talk about it. One of the biggest misconceptions that I've heard is, hey, doesn't that mean I should only list one work? We call that bullet voting. And if we can get the slide up, I'll show you why it actually doesn't help you. But if not, then I'll just do it verbally. Basically, it's this. If you bullet vote, you can give at most 4/5 of a point to your favorite, at most. Most of the works that make the finals will have between 100 and 200 points. You have to get your work all the way up to 4th place so that it is never compared for nominations. Otherwise, it's still going to get eliminated because it's not going to have enough nominations to survive. So bullet voting doesn't do anything for you. All it's going to do is keep you from nominating 4 other works. The odds of you being able to help your work by bullet voting are essentially zero when it comes down to that. And the price that you paid for that was, okay, maybe this one didn't win, but now I've got 4 other chances to get one of my favorites up there. And I realize that this is a voter education kind of thing. We need to, you know, make sure that everybody understands that why bullet voting isn't going to help you. Thank you. If we didn't get it up there, it's going to be okay. It's going to be all right. Okay, in the interest of time then, okay, here we go. Sorry. And so the best strategy is to nominate anything and everything that you feel is Hugo worthy. Okay? And then, so conclusion then. It's a specific fix to a specific problem. It doesn't do anything other than plug the one hole that we have, that we all know is there. And it works with all the other things that we've talked about. It's politically neutral. And again, if there is no slate, EPH won't change anything. So given that, I'm going to open the floor to questions. Thank you.
We have 9 minutes for questions. The chair recognizes Mr. Illingworth.
And there may be a delay with the interpreters to getting the...
Hi, Tim Illingworth. Quick question. So the top nomination getter can never be eliminated, even if he gets in a cage match. The second most highest nominated can only be eliminated if he gets in a cage match with the first nomination, and so on down for 5. Is that right?
Actually, no. Only...
Microphone, please.
Numbers 1 through 4 are safe. They will never come up for elimination because we take it from the bottom up. So it's only the 5th place that's gonna be the one that's going to get in, if I understand your question correctly. Did I misunderstand? I'm sorry. Okay. Go ahead, Seth.
About number of ballots they appear on, not points.
Sorry. The total number of nominees. If the ballot, the slate ones get in, I'll say to the second and third ones, they can still get into a cage match and one will be eliminated.
That is in fact possible if a lot of people voted for both of, you know, 2 of the top 4, it's possible that those could get into a cage match. That's exactly what happens with a slate, and that's kind of the purpose of the system. It could theoretically happen without an intentional slate, but it's very unlikely.
The chair recognizes the gentleman over there.
Oh, God. I'm Alex Von Thorn, the webmaster for Sasquan. And my
Mr. Von Thorn, I recognize the gentleman in the Moby scooter. Sorry. I just said over there.
Mike Stern, rabble rouser. Rabble leader. Sorry, my wife is rabble rouser. The question I have is there any way to do this manually without a computer? Because I put support on Facebook yesterday, and I got all sorts of responses that said, we need some sort of independent manual verification.
The question is there an independent manual verification system so that we do not rely on a computer system that we can't verify?
Yes, but I'm not going to kid you, it's tedious. Now, the algorithm is actually not difficult to implement. Somebody did it in Microsoft Excel without any programming. The current code outputs an audit file that for each round, and this is just my version, we can do whatever we want, but it puts out an audit file so that each round, it tells what's happening with every single work. And so you can trace it back by looking at that audit file. All it's doing is doing the same math that you would do for yourself if you were distributing it. But I'm not going to kid you, it's tedious to go through if there's an issue. But it's there, and we can do it manually.
The chair will note that people approaching the microphone are not going to be recognized just because you're standing up by the microphone.
I will note, I am also a member of a, I also am on this EPA.
He's a mover.
Okay.
So just one more answer to that question very quickly. The way they already do it and they will continue to do it is independently programming it twice in two different programming languages and not actually confirm any results until those two agree exactly.
The chair will also note that currently there are two systems used that verify one another as we do the Hugos now. The chair recognizes Mr. McCarty.
I've been recognized. My name is Dave McCarty. If you recognize me, you're probably having trouble. I am, for those of you that don't know, the Hugo Administrator next year. Regardless of whether this does or does not pass this year, we will be working. I will be working with the gentleman on this to work on how we would manually check the results, which has not been a task that they needed to do so far on their system. But they're, you know, we're going to work on this. So before it would get into use for real, we will find a way to make sure that we can check the results.
The chair recognizes Dr. Adams.
Bingo.
It's been claimed by the proposers of this that it would not substantially change any of the previous list of finalists, but you've only managed to do a sampling on 2013 data and a run on the real data from 84. Now, as has been stated, the real data is not generally available to people. We just had a debate on that. There are, however, people in this room who have, I think, the data from other years. Can I ask if there is anybody who has access to the data who has run it through the proposed system? And if so, can they tell us what their results were?
The chair recognizes Mr. McCarty, since he may have an answer to the question.
He didn't plug this.
Yes, I have completely anonymized LUNCON data. I have completely anonymized LUNCON data from last year. I believe at this point that my modeling of their software was I am not sure that I got things correct. My model for London produced a change, and I don't know if that's a problem with my implementation or the software themselves. I am willing to work with the proposers of this amendment to work through at least two sets of data and possibly three to show what we would get in a non-slate year versus a slate year. Personally, I'd like to do that before we put it in the Constitution. I hope you don't take that as a mean statement. So I'm not generally for that for this year, but I think that we have the ability to do with modern data what we get now, show that it doesn't affect one year where we don't believe there's a slate, and what it does when we know that there is a slate. But that's not data that we will have available to us until next year's business meeting in practical terms.
The chair recognizes the gentleman in the red shirt. Yes, very quickly.
I just wanted to add one thing, that it doesn't have to formally be a slate for EPH to have an effect as well. So, and the classic example is Doctor Who. I love Doctor Who. It's, in my opinion, one of the best science fiction shows on television. But if you think about it, there's five good Doctor Who episodes, and there's some very loyal fans. And so those five Doctor Who episodes are going to be there. They're not intentionally a slate, but is it really the best thing? Maybe you like Orphan Black, you know? And so what EPH would be it would essentially narrow those five nominations down to one. We'd have the very best Doctor Who episode going against the very best Orphan Black episode, and we'd find out what's the best thing on television. So even if they're not a formal mean evil slate, it still has the advantage in how things work today.
One other point, we have actually, there is a statistical procedure called bootstrapping, which uses existing data to create fake extra data thousands and thousands of times. When we did that with the 1984 data, we found that it got the same result about 4.5 out of 5 on average of the nominees in each slate. So it's about 90% the same. It's not that it would be 100% the same, but it would be very close to the same.
Mike Johns, I've been looking at this algorithm, and it seems to me that your tiebreaker contingency number four means that the more organized and cohesive a slate is, the greater the probability that the entire slate would disappear in a puff of smoke in one iteration. Wouldn't it be, if you want to maintain slates as a fair but not over-proportioned representation, shouldn't you replace elimination step number four with a coin flip or some other deterministic way to remove them one at a time in each iteration?
And that's exactly right. We call that a slate with perfect discipline. And what it requires for it to ever happen is that for every single slate member has exactly the same nomination ballots and nobody else votes for any of the other slate works. If any one of those things fails, then you won't have that situation. We have an amendment to change it so that if you guys decide as a tiebreaker you want to eliminate the last one that was nominated or whatever, we can do that. We chose this simply because it's based on what's in the current Constitution.
There is just over 2 minutes left. Mr. Glazer, since you rose in the middle of the speech, for what purpose do you rise?
I actually wanted to ask a question.
The chair will note that speakers must wait until the end of the current speaker to be recognized.
The end of the current speaker.
Mr. Glazer.
Speech. At the end of the speaker, once they die.
Shut. Okay, every description I've seen of this has been a description. What I would call, in computer science, a specification. It is not what I would call an algorithm. An algorithm is a formal statement written in a particular way that drives the way that the computer program that would do this is written. And what I would like to know is there an algorithm in the formal sense which is published for this proposal?
The code is freely available. I have not written it. I'm not a computer science major. I've probably not written it in the format that you want. If somebody wants to show me the format they want, I'll do it that way. It's actually very simple to step through. The code is, again, the code is freely available for anybody who wants to look at it. I've got it on a USB stick with me, and I'll be glad to give that to you for that.
We have a minute and a half left. Dr. Lori.
Bingo. I would like to say that the whole purpose of this is to discourage slates, and making them eliminate each other is a feature, not a bug.
The chair recognizes the woman up front. We have just over a minute and 10 seconds left.
Hello, my name is Joan Young. I have a question for Keith Watt. Is this like single transferable vote?
No, I'm sorry. Can you interpret it and understand?
Is this like single transferable vote? It's a method used in iron.
Not exactly.
Not exactly, although I should probably turn this over to Jameson for this one. It's closest to the Australian
1 minute
election. If you're familiar with it, if you're familiar with the voting theory behind that. It's not much more complicated than the instant runoff voting that we use.
The important difference is that the ballot stays the same, so you don't actually have to rank the candidates. So that's a difference from single transferable vote, and it's the way of saying the same.
The chair recognizes Lisa. There are 30 seconds left, I would note, so a little hustle is...
As this is supposed to be a system to break a slate, I want to make sure it is also not a system to break an unintentional slate. They have not made that clear. Of if we all actually love Doctor Who and didn't like any of the other programs well enough, then they should deserve to get it, not be broken by a system.
The chair.
If Doctor Who had 60% of the voters, they would get 3 of the 5 slates. That's fair.
The chair recognizes Mr. Von Thorn.
10 seconds.
The chair recognizes Mr. Olson.
The chair has been staring in that direction and ignoring people on this side of the room. Please look over the entire room.
Here.
I apologize. I can't look everywhere at once. I will do my best. I did see Mr. Yellowstan, but Mr. Von Thorn rose first.
I just want to ask if the Worldcon committee can pick the software that's not tied to any particular code that may be hard to implement because it's hard to find people to support this.
It's already been implemented in at least three different languages that I know of. It's pretty easy to implement. They could pick whichever.
Question of privilege, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Mr. Stanley.
I move the Microphone.
Kevin Stanley, with the time having expired, I move the committee rise and report.
Is there a second?
Yes.
Are there any objections? Seeing none, the committee will rise and report.
It's 11:49, and the main business meeting will return to order. The meeting would like to hear the report of the Committee of the Whole. Mr. Dashoff or Ms. Dinneroff, do you have a report?
The committee reports with the suggestion that the business meeting take up the 4 and 6 proposal in the manner of fill in the blank.
Okay, well, then when we get to that, we will probably be the first thing to do is to create a blank in the motion and take suggestions for the possibilities to fill the blanks in the current 4 and 6. Okay, before we return to the agenda, I would like to call on the Committee of Tellers to give a report on the Mark Protection Committee election.
All right, Tim Ellingworth, I think we've both spoken, so nobody needs us for bingo.
I'm bingoing myself.
I'm also bingoing him. Bingoception.
My name is Todd Dashoff. Mr. Ellingworth and I counted the ballots from the Mark Protection vote. There were 128 ballots expressing a preference, which meant we needed 64 to elect. On the first round, no one had a majority. We eliminated the lowest total, recounted, and Donald Eastlake was elected. We then proceeded to a second round, which elected Stephen Boucher, and to a third round, which elected Bruce Farr.
Okay, let's see. Is there any objection to commending the tellers and instructing the ballots be destroyed? Hearing none, the tellers are thanked for their work and instructed to destroy the ballots. Thank you. The results of the election are now official. I thought we'd get two birds with one stone, but he's already stepped away. Okay, that takes us back down into the agenda. What person the member rise?
Question of privilege.
The member will come to the microphone and state their question of privilege.
I think that's the correct term.
Yes. Mr. Reynolds.
Yes. I wish to declare
name.
Double bingo.
Mr. Reynolds, and all other members, as much as the chair does appreciate the amusement value of this, this is not a valid question of privilege. Take it elsewhere. We don't have enough time to keep that up. Do not do that again. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. All right, where we were. Yes, open source software. We are back to the resolutions. Do note that items 7, 8, and 9 on the slide number 9 have been dealt with. Items 6 through 9 have already been dealt with, so only items 4 and 5 here are still left. It was adopted at the very beginning of the preliminary business meeting when we moved to suspend the rules and modify section rule 1.2.
Correct.
We jumped into that. So we are on item 4, B24, open source software. Let me get to it there. B24, open source software. Resolved that the WSFS business meeting recommends that software, including but not necessarily limited to, custom written applications, spreadsheets and databases, but not including the hardware, operating systems, or commercial applications upon which such software is dependent, used by a seated Worldcon committee to carry out any function mandated by the Constitution, including but not necessarily limited to administration of the Hugo Awards and future Worldcon selection, shall be made available to any member upon request or as an open source project. That if a committee makes such information available upon request, it must make readily available contact information for feedback, including bug reports. That no Worldcon shall be obliged to use any patch or upgrade suggested during its seeding period, and that such patches or upgrades be considered for inclusion if the software is to be reused by Worldcons seated after the submission is made. With the exception of the typo the chair noted in passing there, the item as printed on page 28 of the agenda is the motion. It's there somewhere. I mentioned it in passing. This should be the on the fifth line of the first clause. I was going to try and set debate. For what purpose does the member rise? First question of privilege. All right. Member will state their question of privilege.
I was given to understand that one of the members of the committee, Ron Oakes, who was here previously, really wished to speak on this matter and had to leave the room to attend to his duties for the convention. Therefore, I would like to move to lay this matter aside and take up the next matter so that he has time to return.
That's a motion to lay the motion on the table. That means the American version, not the British version, that temporarily sets the motion aside without setting a time to pick it back up. It takes a two-thirds vote. Is there a second to lay the motion on the table? Second. With two-thirds vote being necessary to lay the motion on the table, it's not debatable. All those in favor of laying the motion on the table, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposed? Hands down. There being two-thirds in the affirmative, the motion is laid upon the table. Item B25 is MPC funding. Yes, for what purpose does the member rise?
Parliamentary inquiry.
Member will come to the podium and lectern and state their parliamentary inquiry.
Jack Foy, do we need to set a time at which we will take up the motion again?
No, the motion to lay on the table sets the motion aside with no specific time for picking it up. The way you get it back is to make the motion to take from the table anytime there's nothing pending.
Thank you.
Thank you. Take from the table takes only a majority, by the way. All right. Last resolution, MPC funding. I'm the chairman of the MPC as well, and I'm trying to decide if I should... I think I'm going to have to yield the floor because I'm going to make a request. Yes. I yield the gavel to Mr. Dashoff.
I'll let you get off the stage first. The chair recognizes Mr. Stanley.
Kevin Stanley, chairman of the Mark Protection Committee. I note debate time has not been set. That's true. Go ahead.
The chair suggests 4 minutes for debate. Is there any objection?
He's the chair now, not me.
So we've got 4 and 10. Jesse's going to keep track. Any other suggestions?
Eight. I heard a six.
Two.
Come on, people.
All right. Any other numbers? We have 10, 8, 6, 4, and 2. We will start with 10. All members wishing to have 10 minutes, please raise your hands. All those opposed? The noes carry it in the opinion of the chair. 8 minutes. All those in favor? All those opposed? In the opinion of the chair, it is set at 8 minutes. The chair now recognizes Mr. Stanley.
Mr. Chairman, I believe we need a two-minute technical timeout at this point. I move a recess of 2 minutes.
We stand in recess for 2 minutes.
It doesn't matter when I'm doing the math.
The meeting is returning to order.
Mr. Chairman, we have really a crowded agenda, and in addition, this year's Worldcon has already pledged $1, at least, or approximately $1 per voting, by which I mean supporting, attending, and other equivalent members. They've budgeted $10,500 as a donation to the committee. In light of the crowded agenda, I ask unanimous consent to withdraw this motion.
Is there any objection to the committee withdrawing its motion? Seeing none, it is withdrawn.
Why do you sit and wait, Tim, again?
Nobody here cannot see the videographer. It's really hard to see. I believe the YA committee has a statement they'd like to make about signups. Remember, you needed to do that. Oh, sorry, wrong committee. I lost track here. Would the YA committee make a mistake here?
Adam Tesh. Anyone else who's interested in participating in the YA committee, I have a sign-up sheet where we're asking for names and email addresses so that we can add you to the committee. Meet me on the back row right in front of the technical table. Thank you.
The chair is not absolutely sure that he did the reappointments. I believe, but I'm not certain, that the chair the reappointments of the two committees in the standing rules. If I hadn't done so, the nitpicking and flyspecking committee and the Worldcon Runners editorial guide committees are reappointed as currently constituted with the authority to augment their members at their discretion. Yes. And while she gets that down, that deals with all resolutions. Except the one that's been placed on the table, but it can be brought back up when there's no business pending. There is one financial report I would like to hear a statement on, but we're not going to have time to have any statements from the other seated Worldcons. The chair would like to, we are at Worldcon Financial Report, slide 10. The chair would like to recognize Mr. Todd Dashoff.
Thank you. My name is Todd Dashoff. I am the chair of the 2001 Worldcon, the Millennium PhilCon. Our last financial report is included in your package. We have now distributed all of our surplus. On behalf of our committee, I apologize for the time that it took, but I am very glad that it is complete. Because I will make a brief statement, because of the fact that we were unable to figure out a way to confirm that there is an entity called the 75th World Science Fiction Convention that is a 501c3, since we don't know who's going to win yet. We have split the money that we have distributed this year, which already has been distributed, to Sasquan and to Mid-American 2. Sasquan has agreed that if they end up not needing the money, that they will distribute it to the 75th Worldcon, to the Mark Protection Committee, and to the Worldcon Historic Committee.
We have some members rising. Mr. Pomeranz. Stick around, Todd. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, just speak into the mic.
So I was one of the people who spoke strong. I'm sorry, speak John Pomeranz. I was one of the people who spoke strongly at last year's business meeting, both in the course of the meeting and outside the meeting, to Mr. Dashoff and others about the delay in Millennium PhilCon wrapping its books, and suggested that I might try and enlist others to take action to force him to do so. I would like to say that that was not necessary, and that the Millennium PhilCon fulfilled its obligations to WSFS without any outside pressure, as I suggested might happen. So I move that the meeting thank the Millennium PhilCon for resolving this difficult matter.
Is there any objection to adopting the motion to thank the Millennium PhilCon for fulfilling its obligations by acclamation? Hearing none, they are thanked. Thank you. For what purpose does the member rise? Mr. Glazer.
Just to say that the check for the 2017 winner will be available at the site selection
business. Speak into the microphones, people.
I thought it was.
Okay. No, you're not.
Okay, well. I'm Glenn. I'm still Glenn.
There
Glazer.
We go, yes.
So new. Anyway, the check for the winner of the 2017 site selection from Millennium Philcon will be available at the site selection business meeting. I will have it with me there.
Is there anyone else attempting to gain the floor regarding this item? Hearing none, thank you. The Millennium Philcon, as far as a WSFS committee is concerned, is discharged. That takes us to page 14 of the slide deck, and item A.1 in your agendas, popular ratification. This is the first of the constitutional amendments pending ratification. If adopted by majority vote at this meeting, they become part of the Constitution at the end of this Worldcon. Just a moment. You had a question?
No, I just want to see you.
Yes. Once again, the chairman is one of the makers of this motion and will be recusing himself in favor of Mr. Dashoff. Recusing was the word we were shooting there. Sorry, parliamentary or term of art. We should have given you some rules of order.
The chair recognizes Mr. Stanley.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, the motion on the floor before us would add a third stage to the process for amending the Constitution. Currently, we amend the Constitution by passing constitutional amendments at one Worldcon, ratifying them at the second. They become a part of the Constitution at that Worldcon, at the end of that Worldcon, and take effect the following year. This would keep those two stages as they currently stand, and add a third stage of having the members, all of the voting members, including the supporting members and every attending member and equivalent of the following year's Worldcon, be able to vote on site selection in the same way as they vote on site selection. All of the people who are eligible to vote on site selection would be able to vote on the ratification, yes or no. And if more yes votes are cast than no, regardless of how many total votes are cast, then the matter would be ratified and take effect at the end of the third year. Before I continue, I want to make it clear, if this motion is ratified this year, it does not affect anything passed by this Worldcon first. Anything that passes this business meeting is subject to final ratification next year in Kansas City. The process would only begin with things first passed next year in Kansas City. They would then have to be ratified once in 2017 and then voted upon by the 2018 Worldcon. Now, as to why we should do it, we've had a great turnout here, over 200 people. But we have over 11,000 members. Yes, many of them are supporting members, most of them are. But even then, thousands of members of this convention are attending members who can't attend. I receive complaints all the time from people who are even attending members who say, I can't attend, I can't have anything to do with it. This, in my opinion, undermines the credibility of our governance process. I believe that we should allow all of our members, if we're calling them members, we need to give them more membership rights. And one of those rights should be some sort of voice in our rulemaking process. Right now, we allow every member, whether they appear here or not, whether they're attending or supporting, to originate business. But we don't give them a chance to vote on it at any stage in it. I think this would really improve our credibility with our members, and it is an improvement in the process. And therefore, I encourage you to vote in favor of it, regardless of any short-term concerns you have. Do remember, this is a five-year experiment. This meeting must move to re-ratify it in 5 years. So even if we do have some challenges with it, we have one more chance 5 years afterwards to pull it back if we have to. Thank you.
That was a speech in favor. Yes.
Point of order is...
Sorry, point of order. This may have been covered last year, so forgive me if it's a repeat, but the Constitution explicitly forbids remote participation in the business meeting. To what extent does voting constitute participation and thus become impermissible?
Yes.
The chair has asked the parliamentarian to comment, and my comment would be that this ratification vote is really no more a vote at the business meeting than site selection is a vote at the business meeting. It's a separate process that occurs outside of the business meeting and would be in order if this constitutional amendment is ratified.
For what purpose does the member rise? You are recognized.
Chris.
The chair apologizes for not repeating. Mr. Eastlake said that participation in popular ratification does not constitute participation in the business meeting as it is a separate entity outside of the business meeting, much like site selection, and therefore the amendment is in order, or the motion is in order.
My name is Chris Garrett. Again, speaking as the first attending my very first business meeting ever for a con, the reason I'm very much against is theoretically there's two ways to run an organization. Way one is everyone votes on everything. Way two is the organization elects a group of representatives. The group of representatives go out and get smart on an issue, and then they make a vote. I know that's representatives getting smart on an issue is a punchline to a joke, but we have de facto done that here because people who frankly give a damn about what the Worldcon does make the time to be here. People who don't, and there are thousands of people here who really don't care what we do. So if the ones who care come, then they can vote, and those ones that don't.
The chair recognizes, I saw you, the chair recognizes Mr. Miller. I am attempting to look in all directions at once.
Okay. Miller speaking for. Yes, lots of people.
Pointed at your mouth.
Sorry. Tim Miller speaking for. Yes, lots of people don't come to the business meeting. Lots of people don't nominate for the Hugos and don't vote for site selection. By ratifying this, it's not going to require everybody to vote. It's just going to allow more people who can't make it, who are supporting memberships, who may come to this meeting every year but can't make it to a certain Worldcon, to still be involved in the process.
For what purpose does Ms. Secor rise?
Speech against.
The chair recognizes Ms. Secor. And yes.
Hi, everybody. I'm Kate Secor, and I'm from California, where we have popular ratification of laws. Let me explain to you how this does not work at all. The laws are very complicated. They use technical legal language. There's a reason that we use technical legal language for laws. There's a reason that we use technical legal language for business meeting motions. I am concerned, because I have done this, and everyone I know from California has done this, that we have looked at something and said, we don't understand this. We don't know what it does. I don't understand these funny words they're using. They're not in my dictionary. I'm going to vote against it until they can come back with something that explains it to me. There is nothing in this motion that requires even what the California Voter Guide does, which gives you a nonpartisan explanation of what the motion is attempting to do. And I am concerned that if we put this in front of the membership, what we're going to get is year after year after year after year of not being able to do anything because the people that we've asked to look at it don't understand what we're trying to do, don't understand the language that we're trying to do it in, and weren't here to hear the arguments and the explanations and ask questions.
The chair recognizes Mr. Yallo if it's a speech for the amendment. Yes. I see. I will note that I do see the wings, and I am going by
who I see first. I understand there are people in the wings that are trying to get recognition. I am attempting to get you recognition. I promise. Mr. Yao.
Generally, sorry, Beniello. Generally, I tend to agree with a lot of what Ms. Secor said. It is completely likely that this system has a bunch of failure modes as she described. On the other hand, I think it's worth giving a try since it's got a mandatory sunset clause. If we take a look at the results and don't like it, we fix it in 5 years. And quite frankly, I will admit that I have a somewhat different perspective. This is my 45th business meeting. I can wait 5 years. I can't imagine anything that absolutely positively has to be fixed now.
For what purpose does Mr. Blog rise? Mr. Blog.
Gary Blog. I agree with Kate Secor. Just imagine our membership trying to look at E Pluribus Hugo and understanding one word or what they're trying to do. I'm confused myself, and I'm in this business meeting, and I still want more information. We send out something that complicated, that many pages, to the membership. It gets voted down because they don't understand it.
You have a speech for?
They only get that if they ask at the beginning.
The chair notes that makers of the amendment only get recognized to address if they ask at the beginning.
Like to address in favor?
Yes.
The timekeeper will note that there are 30 seconds.
I understand.
Yes, Mr. Matthews.
Winton Matthews, you keep saying that after 5 years this has to be re-ratified. I've read this entire thing and don't find anything.
That's the debate.
I was wondering, where is it?
I got it.
What?
He's out of order.
I am.
The chair finds the member out of order.
Sorry. Leanne Hildebrand. As an elections inspector in the state of California, and someone very familiar with that, and also someone who recognizes the very privilege involved in being able to afford to attend this meeting, whether it's held in Spokane or in Helsinki, it's incredibly important to me that we enfranchise the larger voting population. If we trust them enough to vote for the Hugos, and we trust them enough to vote for site selection, to educate themselves that way. Thank you.
The chair will note that the text about re-ratification of the amendment is at the bottom of page 6 of your agendas. I am, Mr. Rosenblatt, for what purpose do you rise? Is it a speech against, opposed?
Time in favor of the amendment has expired. There is 150 seconds left for speeches against.
Howard Rosenblatt. At this business meeting, we discuss, we debate, we clarify, all of which would not be available through the mail. There's no requirement in this amendment that they be required to watch the proceedings here on YouTube in order to be well informed, in order to cast a vote. I think that it's really important that the voters be informed, and if they can't attend the business meeting, there may be other ways to make them informed, but sending out a ballot is not sufficient.
The chair recognizes Mr. Stanley.
In deference to my co-author on the motion, I'd like to move to extend debate for not more than 2 minutes for the purpose of allowing the other co-author of the motion, Mr. Buff, to address the meeting in favor of the motion.
Is there any objection?
Seeing an objection, we will vote on the motion to extend debate. All those in favor of extending debate by no more than 2 minutes, raise your hands. All those opposed, in the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it. Debate is extended for 2 minutes. The chair recognizes Mr. Buff for a speech for the motion.
Thank you, Warren Buff. Last year, in the supporting documentation for this, we did address the voter information. We indicated that we intend to, if this is ratified, submit a standing rule proposal to clarify how we would send out arguments for and against, and how we would choose, well, the makers of the motion would be the leads for, and the business meeting would choose a lead against. For this process. I don't believe we actually wrote out what the standing rule proposals would be, but we do intend to make them. This would extend that franchise, as we've been saying. We keep talking about the problem of supporting members who don't act like members. Let's give them the chance.
The chair will note that there is roughly 10 seconds left in favor of the amendment and just about 2 minutes against.
No.
The chair recognizes, Ms. Hayes, for what purpose does the member speak for or against? The chair recognizes Ms. Hayes.
There's actually about 3 minutes left against, just so you know.
The chair can't do math.
No, he really can't. Lisa Hayes, though my husband proposed this and I agree with many of his positions, I am personally opposed to it. Because in this day and age, with the number of people involved, the voting would likely be entirely or substantially electronic. I do not want to have a major vote on a position in Worldcon come down to whoever posts to YouTube or to Facebook first, hits their link, and gets 11,000 people to jump over and vote one direction or the other without thinking. This sounds ridiculous, but I know it has happened. Thank you.
The chair recognizes the gentleman in the vest. I will note that there is 10 seconds left for speeches in favor of the motion.
Dr. David Clement speaking against.
That is out of order. Out of order. This is a speech for.
Oh, my apologies. That was not clear to me.
I will recognize the member in the much nicer, no, I shouldn't say much nicer. I still note that you have 10 seconds.
My name is Rachel Axe, and I will make this very brief. If you want to keep the world in Worldcon, you need to make it more accessible to international members, which means allowing remote voting.
They have half a second.
There is half a second left for speeches in favor, and just over 2 minutes speeches against.
In favor.
Against. Yeah.
The chair recognizes the gentleman here if it's a speech against.
Thank you. I'm David Wallace. This is my first Worldcon. I want to say real fast, I had three points against this. One of them's already been fully covered, I think. A year ago, I might have supported it, but I think the events of the last few months have convinced me that this is a bad idea. Excuse me. The first is it extends the ratification period by a year. It's been clear that sometimes we need to be able to act more quickly than that. So I object on that ground. The second is in the events of the last few months, there was an appeal by one of the slate sponsors to go out and get a whole bunch of outsiders to come and get supporting memberships in order to vote against, to vote for the slate. And I believe that this proposal would just encourage more such actions. It's fine to say we want to extend the franchise to the rest of Worldcon, but I think we would have a lot more of these things happening in the future, and I don't think that's good for Worldcon. Thank you, I urge you to vote against.
The chair notes that time for speeches in favor has virtually expired, seeing as how there's only 30 seconds. And there
no,
is
half a second.
Half a second. And there is just over 30 seconds for...
No, just over a minute.
There is a motion to call the previous question. Is there an objection? Or second? Is there an objection?
It's not out of order because he was wrong about how much time is left. There's 67 seconds left.
So there's more than a minute left. It is in order. I apologize. Is there an objection to calling the question? All those in...
He objected.
Yeah.
How many people want to speak?
Two.
No.
No.
Just a show of hands.
There is some members wishing to speak. We will now call the question on calling the question. All those in favor of calling the question, please raise your hands. All those opposed, in the opinion of the chair, the ayes have it, the question is called. We will now vote on the motion. Which page
is it on? Five.
Actually, I'm not going to read it. All those in favor of the popular ratification motion, please raise your hands. All those opposed, in the opinion of the chair, the noes have it. Right. Yes.
I.
For what?
Serpentine vote.
He moves for
the division. Yeah. The member moves for the division of the House. Is there a second? So, we are going to divide the House. We are going to start in favor of the motion, starting at this side. Stand, please rise. We will go down the row and back to the wall and then finish that section, then move to the middle, and then move to the end.
Yeah.
Hold.
This is four.
What do you need?
I was going to say, if you have difficulty standing, just have people near you where...
Hopefully, 11,
27, 69.
Are there any members who do not believe they were counted? Yes. 69 votes in favor. Now all those against, please rise. We will do the same format.
Sixty-five.
67. Ms. Secor.
78. Is there anyone that does not believe they were recognized? As it is 99-69, and there is no simple majority in favor, the motion is not ratified.
So wait a minute. So it's 69 in favor, 99 against.
99 against.
So this motion failed.
I'm going to take it off the table.
Question of the tech team. How, do we need another 2 minutes here? We only got about 15 minutes before adjournment. Are we good? Okay. All right, let's see what we can get through here.
Glenn wants to
take Mr. Glazer, for what purposes, member? Okay, come on. Mr. Glazer.
Glenn Glazer, because Mr. Oakes has returned to the room, I would like to move to bring back from the table the previously laid on the table motion.
Okay, it has been moved and seconded to take from the table the motion B24 open source software. For what purpose? Yes? 10 minutes debate time, and that'll use up the rest of the day, rest of our mess session. We need to adjourn by 12:45. We've got about 15 minutes. What? Okay, don't get up, folks. The meeting is in recess for 1 minute. The meeting will return to order. The motion on the floor is to take from the table motion B24, open source software. All those in favor of taking the motion from the table, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposed? Hands down, the affirmative has it. The motion on the floor is item B24, open source software. And let me get back to it. 28. Thank you. 20. Oh, I see. It's on the bottom of the previous page. Do I need to reread it? It is in your agenda. This is to open source software. Okay, the motion's on the floor. The chair recognizes Ms. Secor.
We need debate time.
Oh, we didn't set the debate time. I'm sorry.
It's
default
10
is
10 minutes.
No, we didn't. That's the default. Is there 10 minutes is the chair's suggestion.
Six. Four.
That's enough. All right. All those in favor of 10 minutes, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposed? 10 minutes is adopted. The chair recognizes Ms. Secor.
Hello, everybody. I'm Kate Secor. This was actually the business I was here to do, not all the rest of this stuff. This motion is here because I think that there is a certain loss of trust among the membership around what's going on with Hugo voting and Hugo nominations. And I'm hoping that if we say to people, well, look, yeah, we're doing this with software, and we've got some really complicated motions that are going to make hand recounts super hard. We've got some really complicated software. But if you know the software, you can go look at it and see what it's doing. I'm not asking that people be forced to open source their software. I know that there's a lot of opposition to doing that. I am not asking that people be forced to change the software that they're using in any given year. Although I think if you get a legitimate bug report, you should probably think about doing that. All I'm asking is that we, as the business meeting, endorse the idea that the software that's used to perform functions that are required by the Constitution be available for people to review if that's what they want to do. And that if they do find bugs, because all software has bugs, it's axiomatic, it's software, that they be able to report them, whether the seated world cons or committees choose to act on that or not. Thank you.
Mr. Oakes.
Ronald Oakes, speaking in opposition. As the primary author or coder of the current website code used for the Hugo nomination process and the main author involved in the voting process. I strongly am opposed to this. All of the software I have written, with the small exception of the stuff that was written for ShyCon 7 originally, has its rights. It's copyright, but the rights are assigned exclusively to the World Science Fiction Society. That does not preclude reasonable requests to examine the software, but it does preclude it getting out into the open by unwarranted sharing of this code. This was done specifically because this code was written for this body, for this purpose. And I did not want to deal with open source. I did not want to go through that. A small portion of the Hugo voting code was based on code originally written by Steve Stanton for Lone Star Con 3. That code is GPL, but the remainder of the code, including that I used to cross-check the counts of the Hugo nomination or the Hugo voting, is available for reasonable requests because it is licensed to this body, but it is not open source, and I'm very strongly against what I see as a somewhat strong arm request to force me into dealing with open source licensing. Secondly, as a professional software developer, as long as I'm writing this and assigning it to a body, I believe I am completely safe from any employment issues. However, if it is forced into the open source, that could cause me professional issues in the future if my employer says, hey, you're dealing with this open source software, and it's in violation of our open source policies. Thank you.
Speech in favor? Yes, Mr. Eastlake.
I'm Donald Eastlake. Mr. Chairman, I would like to move an amendment to strike everything but the first paragraph. So it strikes the last three sections of the motion to simplify it.
Can you, I'm sorry, what are you trying to move?
I'm trying to move to amend the this
motion by striking out what?
Striking the last three parts. The first part, which was resolved through the first half blank line.
Okay, all right, so everything from that, if a committee makes such information available, to strike everything. So to strike the second, third, and fourth clauses of the amendment.
Correct. I'm generally support.
Is there a second to striking the second, third, and fourth clause of the amendment? All right, you get to speak in favor of this.
Okay, I'm generally in favor of
not more than 5 minutes divided evenly, takes out the main time.
I'm generally in favor of a recommendation, not a requirement, in favor of open source, but I think all this stuff about being required to give a contact and bug reports and all this sort of stuff just muddies the issue. I think a statement in favor of open source is fine if we want to do that, but I am opposed to the other parts.
A speech opposed to the amendment striking things out. Yes.
Can you give me like 2 seconds?
Okay. The time. Go ahead and come on up while the timekeeper straightens out the time clock. And we'll wait for the timekeeper's indication that she's ready to take the next speech. Just a moment.
Okay. I'm ready.
Okay. Go on. Yes.
Jack Foy. The stated purpose of this motion is to build trust between the community and the organizers of this process. Part of that trust is being able to trust the infrastructure that we use in order to execute our business as the Worldcon. It is an extremely common practice for us to build trust in the software that we use by asking more people to review it and tell us about places where we have done it wrong. That is essential to this process. It is an added bonus that we also get to study the software and understand what's going on, but the major reason to do this is for us to be able to identify and rectify problems with how we are doing this.
Speech in favor of the amendment to strike the last three clauses, Mr. Kowalczyk. How much time is remaining in favor?
125 seconds, a little over 2 minutes.
I'm still Rick Kowalczyk.
I believe that the amendment actually does accomplish the openness and allows people to review the code without most of the onerous side effects that Ron Oakes is worried about. And should this amendment pass, we can go try to fix some more of the onerous side effects.
That was a speech against striking the last three?
That was four.
That was a speech for.
Yes.
I'm calling for a speech against.
Mr. Speaker, there's an amendment by substitution
of mine. It is.
At this point, I don't think. A substitute for mine, yes.
A substitute for his amendment, yes. You want to move to amend by substituting an amendment for Mr. Eastlake's amendment? It is in order as an amendment by substitution. It's the only time it's in order. Come along and make the motion.
Give me a second.
And wait for both the secretary and the timekeeper have got to get caught up here.
Okay, I'm ready.
Ready on the secretary. Yes. What his member will state his amendment?
I would propose to amend my substitution that replacing the entirety of Mr. Eastlake's amendment with a change striking out makes in the second paragraph and replacing it with should, which would remove all of the onerous.
No. The chair rules that that's an emotion to try and fiddle with the individual strikeouts. So if you want to get that, you need to defeat the amendment to strike out and introduce it as a new emotion.
My recommendation was also incorrect. Having examined the standing rules, it requires that the primary amendment be...
Thank you. All right, yes. Yeah, that's a good point. In fact, the parliamentarian has corrected our original ruling. We were wrong the first time. Do we really need to debate this further? I'll take the motion and say, how many people still wish to debate the amendment to strike out the last three clauses? Is there any objection to ending the debate on the amendment to the resolution? Very well. The question is on amending the resolution by striking out the last three clauses. This does not pass or reject the entire proposition. It merely votes on whether we strike out the last three clauses. All those in favor of striking the last three clauses, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposed? In the opinion of the chair, the affirmative has it. The affirmative has it, and the last three clauses are struck. The resolution now consists only of the first clause, beginning with resolved that the WSFS business meeting and ending with as an open source project. Where were we at when we got into this, and how much time remains?
We now have...
I was nominally a speech in favor.
Speech in favor. So we were on a speech against the revised proposal.
We have 160 seconds in favor, 100 and smidge seconds against, which totals up for a total of 271 seconds, which is...
271 seconds. I think I'd like to... member wants to make an amendment. Mr. Caswell?
Yeah, I'd like to remove the last 6 words.
You've got to go to the microphone. Dennis. Mr. Caswell, sorry.
Yeah, I'd like to make an amendment to remove the last 6 words of the first paragraph to end it at the word request.
It's a motion to strike out the words or as an open source project. Do we need to debate this? I don't think so. Is there anyone who wants to debate it? Thank you. On the motion to strike out or as an open source project, all those in favor of striking those words, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposed? In the opinion of the chair, the affirmative has it. The affirmative has it and or as an open source project. The first clause and thus the entire resolution now ends with the words upon request. I think it was actually nominally a speech for was in the last one once, yeah, so I think we actually pick up with that point because emotions are antithetical to the state. So we now I'll recognize you as a speech in favor of the amended resolution.
With all due respect to Andrew Adams still, with all due respect to Mr. Oakes' concerns about this, I do not believe that making the source code of the software we use available to any member poses any professional risk to those who have developed the software, unless they were being, and I stress I do not suggest that he is, unless they were being incompetent in doing so in the first place. It is making available to our members that is the point of this motion, and particularly now as amended, that is the crux of this.
A speech against? Mr. Harris. See, I'm trying to get both wings. I apologize.
Thank you. Colin Harris. Even with the fact that we've moderated the motion somewhat with amendments, I'm still strongly against it. Not least because the definition of the software in scope, which is anything needed to support the Constitution, implicitly also includes all of our membership administration software and the way we do memberships online and many other things that are typically redeveloped every year. As someone who's worked in IT for 30 years and who also has worked with the Hugo software and site selection systems, there's lots of people who've been involved who've put goodwill in who might think twice if they had to expose that software.
Members are going to have to take their conversations out of the room if they're speaking on radios or microphones. We are very close to time.
So basically, I just think this isn't a good idea. My experience is that people who've come forward offering to help, that help has been accepted. But I don't think we want to be enshrining this as a resolution.
The chair observes that we have reached the end of our time available here. Is there any objection to ending the debate and bringing this motion to a vote? Yes, there is. Is there a motion to close debate?
Yes.
All right. How many people still wish to debate this motion? Show of hands, please. Hands down. All those in favor of ending the debate and bringing the motion to a vote, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposed? Hands down. There being more than two-thirds in the affirmative, the debate is closed. The motion is on the amended open source software, which consists of the printed words all the way up to the words available to any member upon request, and that is all. All those in favor of this resolution, raise your hands. Hands down. Those opposed? Hands down. The opinion of the chair, the negative has it.
I question.
How many people want a division? Raise your hands. The chair believes that is less than 20% of the House, and the chair's ruling is that the negative has it, the resolution fails. It is now 12:45, and we can no longer continue at this point. I want to get you to the point out here. This leaves us undone, and we will try and pick them up tomorrow. Items A2, 3, and 4, the pending constitutional amendments, and then into the new constitutional amendments, of which two-year eligibility is the only one that was killed. The chair, no, tomorrow's meeting starts with site selection business, of which we will have, and question time for the seated Worldcons. The chair would encourage seated Worldcons and their question time and the bidders for 2018 to keep it short. We only have about 2 hours and a little bit of extra time tomorrow because we'd like to get the Worldcon chairs photo session, which takes some time as well. And anything we don't get done, we have to start at the beginning of Sunday's meeting. All right, at 12:47, the first main business meeting is adjourned.